Hello, it's my pleasure to talk to you today at the ImageXD conference. My name is Nicholas Sofroniew and I work at the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative leading the imaging tech team there. I'd like to talk to you today about Napari, an n-dimensional data viewer in Python. It's an open source project, community developed, and I'm excited to tell you all about it today. I'd like to also thank Tyler Lambert, who helped a lot in making the original version of these slides as well. So Napari, as I said, n-dimensional data viewer in Python. Part of our motivation for developing this tool was that we wanted to provide a fast GPU-powered visualization of n-dimensional images and datasets. We want to integrate well with the existing scientific Python ecosystem, where a lot of great image analysis is already happening. And we want to support arbitrary large data, too large for memory, possibly remote. And we wanted the tool to be extensible, customizable. We have a plugin interface and building a plugin ecosystem around the tool. And we also really wanted it to be an inclusive project that was community driven. And we're able to do this by really building on the shoulders of giants. We use VisPy, an open source library for our rendering. We use NumPy and Dask for our representations of array data. And ZAR, another array library that represents image data on disk. And then we use Qt for building our GUI and interactive components. So at the heart of it is the Napari viewer. There is a canvas where you can see images on the right. There's a layer list which shows the data that has been loaded into the viewer already. And there are layer controls that depend on what layer you have selected. Here you have an image layer selected and you can see controls for opacity, contrast limits, gamma, color maps, other things like that. We also have a dimension slider. This data set's actually 3D and we're only looking at a single 2D slice of it right now. And so we have an additional slider for that dimension. We can add and remove layers using buttons on the left. And we can control additional properties of the canvas, whether we're doing 2D rendering or 3D rendering, or which particular axes are being displayed with buttons in the bottom right. Finally, we have a status bar that can show information about where the cursor is other helpful tips. Really, at the heart of it, layers are a central concept in Napari. We have this layer list on the left that I mentioned already. And we can have layers of different types. So here you can see that I've added a labels layer, which is a type of layer useful for representing segmentation data, where you can do additional things like paint or edit labels as well. And you can see that the layer controls are now different because we have a different layer selected. If we add an additional points layer, you can see these points representing locations in space. We again have a different set of controls visible in the control panel in the top left as well that allow us to do things like the size of the points or their face color and edge color. So as I said, layers are a really fundamental concept in Napari, and we've got about six or seven different types here, image, labels, points, vectors, tracks, surface, and shapes. And so if we go through a couple of these, as mentioned, image is really our probably most fundamental. You can have 2D rendering, 3D rendering, adjust contrast limits, color maps. And here, we work really well with array-like data. So from NumPy or Dask or even data backed by ZAR. And we can also support multi-resolution sort of pyramid image data. So this is an electron micrograph that's hundreds of thousands by hundreds of thousands of pixels. And in sort of lazy loading fashion, kind of Google Map style, we can load in just the amount of information that you want to see on the screen at any moment in time. And then so that allows you to sort of retain interactivity even in this really, really big data set. We also can do dynamic loading and processing from disk or remote data. So in this example, we have some raw lattice light sheet data that is being loaded and then deskewed and deconvolved on demand. It's a really nice example from Tyler Lambert that's actually in one of our tutorials. And so every time the dimension slider moves here, which in this case represents time, it's a time series, we're loading in this 3D data and then deskewing and deconvolving on the fly. And what's really nice about this is it means that you don't have to then have a second copy of the data set. You know, you may be interested in viewing the deconvolved data, but you can just have a copy of that raw data and then do this processing on the fly when you need it. So if we look at our next layer type labels, you can see here it's possible to paint, we can fill, we can look here at the boundaries of labels, and this is very useful for segmentation, and you maybe have a cell segmentation or another type of segmentation mask that you want to represent and edit. You can also have, in this case, we have an anatomical map from the Allen Brain Atlas where individual regions have labels too, and you can see it in sort of 2D and 3D as well. So another fundamental layer type for us is points. So we can scale to millions and millions and you know, hundreds of millions of points. This is a point cloud here in 3D. And you know, points are individually sort of colorable and editable as well. And this is really using the advanced scene graph capabilities and rendering capabilities of VisPy here to make this highly performant, where the rendering is happening using the graphics card. Vectors is another one. This is some nice cryo-EM data from Alistair Burt. And here he's using the vectors layer to indicate the orientation of sort of features of interest in the data set. There you can see all those lines. We also have a really nice tracks layer, which you can use for tracking particles or tracking cells. This was actually contributed by Alan Lowe as part of his work on the Arboretum package, a package he has for lineage tracing and tracking in Python. And it's really been a wonderful addition to Napari. And so then our next layer type are surfaces. And so here you can see the surface, and this is really a mesh representation of a brain, a cortical surface. And we can even have sort of time series of surfaces, so these sort of changing values from measurement of brain and surface activity that we can represent here in the part two. And then finally, our final layer is shapes. And so here you can see shapes you can edit as polygons. And so, you know, if you want to do a sort of segmentation around region of interest using polygon, that's possible. You can edit these polygons, draw additional ones, excuse me. And edit their properties. Here you have to select this one, you can select it, and then edit its color, for example. So, you know, layers, as I said, really fundamental, you know, concept in Napari. And, you know, another thing that is really core to Napari is interactive analysis. And so here, you can see we've got a console down at the bottom. This could be a Jupyter notebook or an IPython terminal too. And we've added points layer here. And if we look at the points data right now, it's empty. There are no points. But if we go and manually start adding some points, and then we come back to the console and we look at the points data, now you can sort of see a NumPy array. And if we ask how many points there are, it's 4. If we add some more and then come back to the console, you can see that we've got 7 now. And so, you know, this is really nice because you can be doing things in the GUI, interacting, and then you can go into the console and really just get access to those Python objects right away. And so this is really great if you're developing you know, new analyses or want something interactive as well. And then we really try and integrate with the scientific Python ecosystem. So this great example from Juan Nunez Iglesias is looking at training a machine learning model in Napari as a denoising model from Batson and Roy. And it uses scikit-image under the hood for some pre-processing, scikit-learn for some of the ML, and PyTorch for some of the L machine learning too. And then that bottom plot where you're seeing the loss against batch number is a matplotlib plot that's been integrated in Napari. And so, you know, in the top you can see on the right side is the raw noisy data, on the left side is the machine learning prediction. You can see it sort of getting better and better as the machine learning model trains more and more. And you know, it's nice that we don't, you know, you can see how we don't lose interactivity despite training in this fashion. So installation of Napari, you can install via pip install Napari or install with Conda. There are more details on installation on our website, napari.org. We also have a bundled app where no additional installation of Python is required, and those are on our release page. And we're really, you know, trying to make Napari accessible to those that don't know Python as well. And so, you know, more work still to come here, but it's definitely a goal of ours. And so with that, let me talk to you a little bit more about plugins and our plugin ecosystem. So Napari itself is, you know, pretty domain and analysis agnostic. You know, we provide these fundamental objects and interactivity, these layers. But then we have a plugin model that allows users to provide custom analyses, custom interactivity, or custom sort of file I/O and other things like that. So, you know, we've got a number of plugins for input-output, sort of reading and writing data, Nikon files, CCI files, NDTIFFs, other things. And we also have some kind of GUI or widget plugins as well for segmentation or self-finding and others. So we have a built-in plugin installer that you can load up directly from Napari, and that will allow you to install a Napari plugin from the Python package index directly into the tool. The team at CZI is working on Napari Hub. Justin Kiggins is leading this work with a number of very talented engineers, user researchers, and designers. This is going to be a plugin discovery and distribution site online. It's going to be a place where people can go to discover, share, and install Napari plugins. There'll be a sort of page for each particular plugin in addition to that search page where you can learn and read more about it, and then instructions on how to install that into Napari. So really excited for that to come. That's not released yet. It's gonna be released this summer, and should be a great addition to the ecosystem. If you're interested in making an Napari plugin, we've got this wonderful cookie cutter repository. It's a ready-made template for creating Napari plugins. It includes a lot of the packaging and distribution boilerplate. So built-in testing, version control, continuous integration. And you know, if you're looking to get started making an Napari plugin, this is really the place to start. And you know, we've got some additional documentation and guides on our website too. So one of the things we have as well is MagicGui, which is a tool that will do auto-generation of widgets from Python types, really spearheaded by Tally Lambert in the community. In this example, you can see we're sort of passing a scikit-image function through MagicGui, and we're auto-generating a widget that allows you to kind of control some of the parameters of that function too. And so this is really useful if you're developing a plugin, but you might not want to do a lot of custom GUI coding. You can leverage MagicGui to do auto-generation of a widget from some of your functions too. And so if I plot some of the nice plugins in the ecosystem right now, we've got Napari Animation, which is really some great contributions here from Alistair Burt and Guillaume Woods. And this allows for making an animation in Napari. You can sort of select keyframes, and you can see here how we're moving between them, and we'll sort of interpolate the views as well. And so this is you know, really useful for making animations. We've also got Napari Omaros. It's a graphical Omaro client within Napari from Thailand and Will Moore from the OME team. And you know, this is a really great example of collaboration between Napari and OME. And you know, we really look to kind of collaborate and work well with existing software in this space where possible. And so here, you know, you're able to browse your Omaro instance and you know, view data then directly into Napari. This is a great example of OpenCL processing Napari PyCL Esperanto Assistant and pipeline management and interoperability with Fiji from Robert Haas at Dresden. And you can see here how he's able to make a script and then run it in Napari and then immediately also run it in Fiji too. And you know, we're really excited about this interoperability with Fiji and ImageJ as well, and really trying to connect as much again to the great work that those teams have been doing over the years as well, and interact with them as much as positively as possible. Finally, on the plugins, this is Affinder, an example of some Affine image registration from Juan Nunez Iglesias as well. You can sort of load in different types of images, select some control points, and then that will lead to a sort of registration that you can kind of continue to edit and interact with at the same time. So with that, I want to thank the Napari development community. You know, we have a steering council of Juan, Loic, and myself, incredible core developers, including Tally Lambert, Kira Evans, and Justine Larson, Shannon, Axelrod Yang Liu, Genevieve Buckley, Kevin Yamachi, and Amit Kansolak. And, you know, Kira did a lot of work getting this this project going. Tally's really done an incredible job driving on a lot of really important features over the past couple of years. And you know, we're really excited to have contributions from many, many, many more folks as well. It's, you know, over 72 people have contributed, and you know, we're really trying to create a sort of inclusive and welcoming contributor community where, you know, even if this is your first time contributing to open source, we'd you know, we'd love to have you and help you get started as well. So there are a number of places where you can find us and join us. So napari.org, we've got our homepage, tutorials and documentation there. We have our GitHub, our Napari, this is where the source code is, and our issue tracker as well. We're you know, very active on the ImageXD forum, answering questions there. This is probably the first place to go if you're a user and you have questions. And then you can find us on Napari Zulip as well. So this is a place for real-time chat and conversations. And then we're active on Twitter too. We have a Napari Imaging Twitter handle, and you know, it's really great to see people in the community sharing out what they've done with Napari as well. And you know, gives us you know, inspiration and ideas for what to improve to. We've also got a series of sort of developer and community meetings. So we've got three now that happen at times kind of spread out across the day, so that you know, we're really friendly for all time zones now. You know, so an international community, and you know, everyone is welcome at those meetings too. And you can reach out to us on Zulip if you want more information about them. And so with that, I just want to thank you again for listening to my talk. It's really been my pleasure to talk to you today, and I hope to catch some of you in some of the discussion time during the conference as well. Thanks again.